In this episode of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory, we'll look at the Bootes and Corvus region and show you how to find these beautiful deep sky objects. The globular cluster M3. The Antennae Galaxies. And the massive edge-on galaxy, Messier 104. All right, let's go star hopping. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 23 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm totally electrified to be your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. Well, now we're back after two extra episodes to be star hopping around the sky once again. Two episodes ago in our discussion about the different types of star clusters, we talked about globular clusters. We'll look at a splendid example of one tonight when we check out our first object. I wanted to start off with a new type of target because the other two targets are both galaxies again. But they're definitely worth the effort of finding them because they're both striking and beautiful targets. So let's get going with our first target, Messier 3, a massive globular cluster in the constellation of Bootes, the Herdsman.
Star hopping target number one.
M3 is one of the largest and brightest globular clusters in the sky. When you see it rising in the east, you know that spring is not too far away. A few degrees below, you'll find the real herald of spring, though. It's the bright orange star Arcturus, which dominates the eastern sky these nights in early March. And following the best traditions of star hopping, we'll use this fiery beacon as our starting point in our hop to M3. So center your scope on Arcturus and take in the amazing view. Arcturus is the brightest star in the constellation of Bootes. At magnitude -0.05, it's the brightest star in the northern hemisphere, and it's the fourth brightest star in the night sky, following Sirius, Canopus, and Alpha Centauri. Arcturus is only 37 light years away, and it has a diameter 25 times that of the Sun. In the eyepiece, its ruddy orange color is immediately noticeable in even the smallest telescopes. So now let's start our hop from Arcturus to M3. We'll jump over a couple fifth magnitude stars in order to get there. First, move to the upper left about 5 degrees to fifth magnitude D Bootes. Now move up about 3 degrees and slightly left, and you'll find fifth magnitude 9 Bootes. Now move straight up about 3 degrees, and you'll see a 500,000 stars move into your eyepiece. That's M3. No, really, there's 500,000 stars that compose this massive cluster. As with any globular, pop in your high-power eyepiece and see if you can resolve individual stars near the core. At magnitude 6.2, M3 is visible to the naked eye under very dark sky conditions, and it's just a superb object with the slightest optical aid. In binoculars, it appears as a hazy nebulous patch. At a distance of 34,000 light years, M3 is further away than the center of the Milky Way. The cluster has an age of roughly 8 billion years and contains mostly old red stars. So wasn't that great? A target that wasn't a galaxy. I know we've hit a slew of galaxies over the last month on star hopping, but that's what's up now. So if I can indulge you just a little bit further, I have a couple of special galaxy treats for you, and we'll see the first one right after this.
Hopping target number two.
So a few weeks ago when we were hopping through Markarian's chain in the Virgo cluster of galaxies, we saw the interacting pair of galaxies called the Eyes. Very often when two galaxies pass each other in space, their massive gravity starts to make them interact, and they steal huge amounts of stars from each other. And the interaction sends their spiral arms flinging off in wild directions. That's the case with our second target tonight, the Antennae Galaxies. NGC 4038 and NGC 4039 are known as the Antennae, or sometimes called the Ringtail Galaxies. They're located near the western edge of the constellation of Corvus the Crow. As they passed by each other, the interaction sent two long streamers of stars flying out from the galaxies themselves. The result looks like a little celestial bug with long antennae. Although the two galaxies themselves are not very large, spanning only 5.5 arc minutes across individually, the two streamers span 40 arc minutes from tip to tip. The combined pair shine at magnitude 10.3. So the constellation of Corvus the Crow is easy to spot. It's shaped like a trapezoid and lies about 15 degrees to the right of bright Spica in Virgo. The most conspicuous star in Corvus is third magnitude Algarab, with its close companion Eta Corvi. Algarab will be our starting point for the next two star hops. So center up your scope on Algarab and we'll move forward to find a celestial bug. From Algarab, move about 3 degrees to the right to second magnitude Giana Corvi. About 5 degrees to the right, you'll move into the constellation of Crater the Cup to find fifth magnitude 31 Crater. Now move about 3/4 of a degree back to the upper left, back across the border into Corvus, and you'll spy the two interacting ovals that form the Antennae Galaxies. In small telescopes, 6 inches or less, the antennae look like two spiral galaxies that touch. In other words, they appear as two elongated fuzzies that blend into one irregular blob. Larger scopes can reveal the dark patch that lies within the V formed by the edge of the galaxies where they touch. Another thing to look for in larger instruments is the beginning of the southern streamer, which appears visually as a single stubby tail. Our next target is one of the most wondrous edge-on galaxies in the heavens, and we'll learn all about it right after this.
Star-hopping target number 3.
Messier 104, also known as the Sombrero Galaxy, is one of the most famous edge-on galaxies in the sky. It's a classic example of spiral galaxy structure, because it's easy to see the nuclear bulge of the galaxy, the spiral arms cutting across the center of the nucleus, and the galactic halo that contains all the galaxy's globular clusters. Although the galaxy is visible with binoculars or a 4-inch telescope, at least an 8-inch telescope is needed to distinguish the bulge from the disk, and a 10 to 12-inch scope is needed to see the dark dust lane. So let's locate this impressive galaxy. We'll start again from Algarab and Eta Corvi, so get that pair centered up in your eyepiece. Now move about 4 degrees to the left to fifth magnitude VV Corvi. Now move about 1.5 degrees to the upper left, and you should see the oval shape of Messier 104. If you have a larger scope, see if you can see the dark lane running across the center of the galaxy. In the KPO reflector, it's pretty obvious in a dark sky. We're lucky that Corvus rises in one of the darkest sections of the sky at KPO, and this image taken with the KPO 18-inch shows the dark lane very well. So let's review our star hops in their early spring eastern sky for this week. We started off at bright orange Arcturus in the constellation of Bootes and found the massive 500,000 star globular cluster Messier 3. Then we moved down to the constellation of Corvus and made a two-star hop to the interesting interacting pair of galaxies known as the Antennae Galaxies. Then we moved up from Algarab and Eta Corvi to locate the amazing Sombrero Galaxy, cataloged in position 104 in the famous Messier list. See, those two galaxies are pretty great, but next time we'll be looking at three more globular clusters, and they're also very impressive targets. So that does it for this week's episode. You can find the show notes on our website at kpobservatory.org/SH023, where you can comment and leave any questions that you might have. Thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week in our episode of Star Hopping.
I'm Cassie, and I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these video astronomy tutorials every week on Thursday, and in their podcast format on Fridays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them on the internet. The reason we create these videos and podcasts is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests for potential targets in the night sky that you would like to see us discuss, just let us know down in the comments section below, or on our website blog. Don't miss our free field notes for this episode, basically the script of the show, with all the images and star charts we use for our star hopping activities. You can get them for free at kpobservatory.org/fieldnotes. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button, click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. Also, as I just mentioned, please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astronomical digital images, and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places in cyberspace, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts, and help us make even more great astronomy tutorials, just like this one. So bye for now, and thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.